Hello students, welcome to Zoology classroom. In today's session, we are going to discuss about origin and salient features of acanthodia. So before entering into the topic, let us have a look at this slide. We have already discussed about this slide in previous lectures also. So this is a classification of phylum Chordata. So as we have already discussed, the phylum Chordata is classified into two groups. One is Acraniata, which comprises of Urochordata subphylum and Cephalochordata subphylum. Another subphylum is Vertebrata or Craniata. These organisms are possessing vertebrae in their back region and or cranium or skull in their head region. In this vertebrata, it is classified into two divisions. One is Anata, another one is Natostomata. So Anatans, they were having jawless heads. So they are called as jawless vertebrates also. And this Anata includes two groups. One is Ostracodermi and another one is Cyclostomata. Ostracodermians are extinct fishes and Cyclostomes are living now. And coming to Natostomata, these are having jaws in their heads. So they are called as jawed fishes, and this jawed fishes, they have classified into two superclasses. One is Pisces, another one is Tetrapoda. And in Pisces, we have seen that extinct fishes are classified into two classes. One is Placodermi and another one is Acanthodia. And two extant or living groups are there. One is Chondrichthyes, another one is Osteichthyes. So in today's class, we are going to discuss about Acanthodia, the extinct fishes. So the classification of Acanthodia is this. They belong to Eukarya domain, Animalia kingdom, phylum Chordata, and subphylum Vertebrata. That are division, Natostomata, Unatostomata, and class Acanthodia. So the Acanthodians, like Placodermians, they also came into existence when these ostracoderms were disappearing some 450 million years ago. And they are the these are also the first jawfishes. And earlier, the first jawfishes were called as a single category, but now this single category is split into two groups. One is Placodermi and another one is Acanthodia. So these Acanthodians, they were freshwater organisms. They resemble shark fishes. So they superficially look like shark fishes. And usually they had elongated fusiform bodies, and the bodies are almost look like eel fishes. And their bodies were covered by diamond-shaped scales on their bodies. And a common fossil found that belong to the Acanthodia group is genus Climacias. This Climacias was about 8 centimeters long, so very small size organisms are these. So between larger pectoral fin and pelvic fins, between these two pectoral and pelvic fins, they had extra smaller paid fins, and some of which in the form of stout spines, hence they got the name spiny shark. So as this extra fins, they appear like spines, so the extra spines are called as with the presence of these extra spines, these fishes are called as spiny sharks. So some of these Acanthodians, they had true teeth, especially on the lower jaw. So the Acanthodians, they survived into earlier Permian period before they became extinct. That means they came, disappeared from the earth in this Permian period. And coming to origin, like this, Placodermians are also nothing recovered that can be said that as an ancestor to this group, like Placodermians. So Acanthodians are also, we do not have any ancestor fossils for this Acanthodian group also, like Placodermi. So scientists are opinion that the Acanthodians must have arisen from some jawless vertebrates, probably that were living in freshwater bodies. And they appear to have been active swimmers. and they also have no head armor. So like placodermias, they do not have head armor. So that's why without the presence of this armor, these placodermians were separated from placodermy group, and a separate class designation was assigned to them. And they were possessing this large eyes. So presence of this large eyes indicates that they were highly dependent on vision. So they were dependent on vision sensation, vision sense. So perhaps they preyed on invertebrate organisms. The rows of spines and spine-like fins between the pectoral and pelvic fins give some credence to the idea that these preyed fins and spine-like fins arose from fin folds along the body sides. And the relationships of acanthodians to other jawed vertebrates are obscure. They are not very clear. So they possess both features found in both sharks and bony fishes. That means they exhibit both the characters of osteichthyes and chondrichthyes fishes. That's why we cannot clearly say that they belong to these sharks or bony or osteichthyes fishes. So acanthodian, they do not seem particularly close to placodermy. Although, like placoderms, they apparently possessed less efficient tooth replacement and tooth structure than the sharks and the bony fishes. So, the present bony fishes, present sharks possessing, they are having a very powerful tooth in these organisms. But these placodermians and acanthodians, they were lacking this well-efficient tooth. So this must be the reason for their extinction. So later in the course of evolution, some new organisms originated that were having a strong jaws and strong teeth. As these placodermians and these acanthodians, they were lacking the strong teeth. So the lack of strong teeth resulted in the extinction of these groups. At the beginning of this decade, the scientists were of opinion that these acanthodians are both very close to ancestors to both osteichthyes fishes and chondrichthyes fishes. The reason for this opinion is that they mostly studied a fossil, that is acanthodes. So they were mostly studied acanthodes before before this 2013 year. So this acanthodes was exhibiting both these features of chondrichthyes fishes and osteichthyes fishes. That's why they felt that the acanthodians are ancestor to both osteichthyes fishes and chondrichthyes fishes. But in 2013, some new fossil was discovered by scientists. The name of the fossil is Entylonathus. So this Entylonathus is exhibiting a bony fish jaw features. So this led to the revision of this clade. So now scientists are opinion that acanthodians are now believed to stem chondrichthyes, and the clade from which sharks and rays or chimeras evolved from. So now presently scientists are opinion that acanthodians are the ancestors to only chondrichthyes, but not to the osteichthyes fishes. So here in this slide, we can see the two evolutionary trees. So the first evolutionary tree was before the invention or before the discovery of this Entylonathus. So in this first diagram, you can see this. You concentrate on this blue of fishes only. Okay, this green fishes are placodermians. These two are placodermians. So some placodermians gave rise to these acanthodians. So in these acanthodians, scientists were of opinion that they are having both the features of chondrichthyes fishes and osteichthyes fishes. So here in this tree, we can see these orange color ones. This branch is of chondrichthyes group. And this branch, this yellow branch, the middle branch is of the osteichthyes fishes. And this third branch, this belongs to this tetrapodons. Okay, so as scientists were of opinion that the Acanthodians are possessing both the characters of this astrictis fishes and chondrichthyes fishes. They have placed this group in between these two branches. So you can clearly see this branch is split into two branches. The stem is split into two branches. One branch is giving rise to chondrichthyes fishes, and another branch is giving rise to this astrictis fishes. So after the discovery of Entylonathus, so before this Entylonathus discovery, the scientists studied some fossils. They were possessing both these characters of chondrichthyes fishes and astrictis fishes. That's why they thought that the Acanthodians are ancestors to both this astrictis group and chondrichthyes group. But with the discovery of this Entylonathus clearly shows that they are having only not ossified bone only, chondrichthyes bone only, so that now they have reconstructed this phylogenetic tree. So in this reconstructed tree, we can see this lower picture. So in this thing, we can clearly see this, all these blue branches and blue fishes, they represent this Acanthodian. So now these Acanthodians are thought to be the ancestors to only the chondrichthyes fishes. So this is the chondrichthyes group. So now the Acanthodians are thought to be ancestors to only chondrichthyes fishes, but not to the chondrichthyes fishes. So this is the revision of this status of this Acanthodian group. So coming to the salient features of these organisms, they were having elongated fusiform bodies, almost eel-like structures, so, and with a blunt snout. And eyes were very large, and they directed in forward direction, and mouth was placed terminally. Tail was of heterocercal type, and there were two dorsal fins in most fishes, and in these are two fishes. One was reduced and a single anal fin was present in them, and series of fade fins supported by large spines were present between the pectoral fins and pelvic fins. So with these presence of these large spines only, they got this spiny fishes name, and they were quite numerous in primitive forms and became reduced to none in the subsequent stages. So these spines, large spines were present in the primitive Acanthodians, but in the higher Acanthodians, or the Acanthodians that came into existence at the later stages, these were reduced in number. And a well-formed pectoral girdle is also present in these organisms. In this pectoral girdle, each half was composed of a scapula and coracoid bones. And this coracoid bone was supported by these spines of these respective fins. And traces of basal elements were present in these pectoral fins. The body was covered by small rhomboid scales. The scales were dermal derivatives and were essentially composed of bony material. And on the head region, the scales became enlarged and formed definite patterns of arrangement. The scales were comparable to gonoid type of scales. And the neurocranium, jaws, and branchial arches were mostly cartilaginous in nature. So earlier, the cranium, all the structures were of were thought to be of ossified bone in nature, but later with the invention of this next new specimen, it was found that they were cartilaginous in nature. So the jaws were primitive, and they were having four ossified areas, two in the lower jaw and two on the upper jaws. In the upper jaw, it was having palatoquadrate bone. The upper jaw was composed of two pieces and was toothless, so no tooth were present on the upper jaw. Lower jaw was made up of a mandible, and this lower jaw possessed teeth also. So the teeth were, they were nothing but they were modified scales. So scales only, they took the shape of teeth. The hyoid arch was an unmodified branchial arch. So the second branchial arch was modified into hyoid arch, and mandibular, hyoidal, and all the branchial arches in the primitive forms were provided with smaller opercular folds. But in the higher forms, the mandibular operculum became highly developed to cover the gills. So these are the salient features of Acanthuria, Acanthurian features. So with this, we have finished this topic. And in next class, we will meet with another topic. Till then, bye.